Welcome to Pediatric Dentistry Part 3. This is the last lecture of the lecture series on Pediatric Dentistry, and in this lecture we're going to look at two procedures, that is apexification and apexogenesis, and we're going to learn about which cases to do them and which cases not to do them, and how do you know how to go about it. So look at this case. A 13-year-old male child reports with a chief complaint of severe nocturnal pain in lower right back region since 3 days, and on examination you find an IC-03 deep carious lesion with tooth 4-5. Now, what would be your provisional diagnosis for this tooth 4-5? What would be your next step in the clinical management of this particular tooth, and what clinical challenges you're going to face when you are going to restore this tooth back into form and function? Well, this tooth has got a provisional diagnosis of irreversible pulpitis, and as the diagnosis says, the next clinical step would be to perform an RCT. But to perform an RCT, the clinical challenge here is that if you look at the apex, it is wide open, so therefore you cannot do a conventional RCT in this case. So we need to think of some other treatment option for this case. Let's look at this case number 2. A 10-year-old patient reports with a history of traumatic injury to the upper front teeth 1 hour ago, and on examination you find that tooth 1-1 and 2-1 has got a complicated crown fracture, which means that this is a fracture of dentine, enamel dentine, and exposing the pulp. Now, in this particular case, what clinical challenge are you going to face when you're going to restore this tooth back into form and function? Obviously, you see the pulp, the root apex is wide open, and therefore your conventional root canal therapy will not work, and we need to think of something else to preserve whatever pulp is there. So in both these cases, you will realize that the root apex was wide open, and this is the term used for such cases, immature permanent teeth or tooth. That means the root apex are open and they have not formed and they have not closed. There is no apical closure, and that is what is meant by an immature tooth. So here, when we talk about immature tooth, we not only look at the root length, but we also look at the root thickness. The root thickness, right? So if you see the picture on your left, you will see there is a open immature permanent tooth, which can be associated with a vital pulp or a reversible pulpitis. Or you can see in the radiograph on the molar on your right, which shows a deep carious lesion. Again, the root apex is open in this particular case. So when you talk about root apex, how they are? They are classified as blunderbuss or non-blunderbuss. So basically, the gun that you see on your right side, that was the blunderbuss gun with a very wide opening. So we say a root apex which is as wide as that, it is called as a blunderbuss apex. And if the root formation has gone on for a certain time and then the root formation is stopped, and then you have something called as the non-blunderbuss, which is on your right side of the screen of the central incisor. So we must realize, whenever we take a radiograph and we are assessing the root development, these are the two kinds of roots that you will come across. So now let's see the treatment options that are available to treat the cases that we saw earlier in case 1 and case 2. So let's see what is an apexogenesis. As the name says, apexo is something to do with the root apex, and genesis means to form. So here we are helping the tooth to form its own root, right? So we are not interfering, we are just assisting, facilitating the root to form its own apex. So here the important thing is that we need to keep the radicular pulp vital, or in this particular case selection, the radicular pulp should be vital. So we preserve the vitality of the tooth so that the radicular pulp will continue to form the root apex. So it is quite obvious that in any case where you find that the radicular pulp is irreversibly damaged or necrotic, you cannot do apexogenesis, right? So just remember, apexogenesis, genesis is to form. So letting the tooth form its own root by protecting the radicular pulp. So how can you achieve apexogenesis? So apexogenesis is basically the whole process, which is the outcome of your treatment. Now this treatment outcome of apexogenesis can be achieved by the three ways that is there on your screen. One is the cervix or partial pulpotomy, or coronal or conventional pulpotomy, or by direct bulb capping. So if you see the case picture which is given on the left side of your screen, so we have a traumatic injury and we have a pulp exposure there marked by the black arrow, and now we need to take a decision on what, how to preserve the vitality of the tooth so that the root apex can continue physiologically on its own. So what we can do is we can do a direct pulp capping, we can do a partial cervix pulpotomy, which is the removal of only 2 mm of exposed pulp, or we can do a normal conventional pulpotomy, which is removal of the coronal pulp of the tooth. Now here the thing that you must remember is you do apexogenesis only for the permanent tooth, you don't do it for primary teeth, you understand? And then the medicament that is used in this is hard setting calcium hydroxide, MTA, biodentine. We do not use ferric sulfate, we do not use formoterol, we do not use anything else. So these are the dental materials that has to be used in apexogenesis. So direct pulp capping, we have already learned earlier in the first lecture on pediatric endodontics how to do the direct pulp capping. We have also learned how to do conventional pulpotomy and cervix pulpotomy in the previous lecture where we discussed about pulpotomy and pulpectomy. Okay, so make yourself clear, apexogenesis is an outcome of treatment, and we achieve this by any of the three methods listed here, that is direct pulp capping, cervix or partial pulpotomy, and coronal and or conventional pulpotomy. So it is pulpotomy. Now look at this radiograph carefully and tell me what treatment has been done with in this radiograph. Take a few seconds, look at it, analyze it, and tell me how it is. Okay, so this is from case number 2 that we saw. This is a 10-year-old boy with a traumatic complicated fracture of the crown, and we need to restore the tooth back into form and function. So if you see, the radio opaque filling is only in the coronal area of the crown, which is indicating that a coronal pulpotomy or conventional pulpotomy has been done. So when you remove the coronal pulp, okay, when you place a layer of calcium hydroxide, hard setting calcium hydroxide over the remaining radicular pulp, you can place an MTA or you can place a biodentine. The only clause is that the remaining radicular pulp should not bleed. If the radicular pulp is bleeding when you're trying to achieve hemostasis with your moist cotton pellet before you apply your calcium hydroxide or MTA or biodentine, if the radicular pulp still bleeds, then you have to go to the next option, which we will discuss a little later. We cannot do the apexogenesis by coronal pulpotomy. Alright, so we'll go on to the next, and we look at the problem here. If we have an immature tooth and where the pulp has died, okay, so in situations where you have an immature tooth with a vital pulp or maybe a pulp with reversible pulpitis, we can do apexogenesis by cervix pulpotomy, conventional pulpotomy, or simply by direct pulp capping. So what happens to the teeth where the pulp has already undergone degeneration, is already necrosed, is already non-vital? So in this case, we cannot have the apical closure. We cannot have the apical closure because there is no pulp. So what we need to do is we need to do something else. Okay. Now the conventional treatment for such teeth would be to perform a root canal treatment, right? And what do you do in the root canal treatment is you make an access cavity, you debride the canals, and then you fill it with gutta percha, obturate it with gutta percha, and then you place your post endodontic restoration. But in these situations, you cannot achieve a good disinfection because the lumen of the radicular root canal is quite wide, and you cannot file the roots because they are already thin, their thickness is thin, so you cannot file them and make it more thinner, otherwise they become prone to fracture. So we cannot achieve a good disinfection here. And of course, even if we achieve good disinfection, the widest of the widest gutta percha will pass through the open root apex into the periradicular area, which will again is going to give the patient a lot of pain postoperatively, and we cannot have a gutta percha extruding in the periapical region. So there again, the gutta percha filling cannot be done. And because of the thin root thickness that I mentioned, these teeth are more prone to fracture. So we need to do something by, you know, artificially creating a barrier at the apex against which the root canal obturation can be completed. So this process where you try to induce an apical calcific barrier in a tooth which has got a necrotic pulp and which is immature, because the pulp root development cannot proceed because the pulp has died, is called as apexification, right? So what this does is that it takes the help of the remaining Hertwig root sheets in the periapical area, try to stimulate them, and from that stimulation maybe we can get an osteoblast like cells or cementoblast like cells or osteoblast like cells, and those cells will come, they will differentiate, and then they will try to form the calcific barrier, and then we can have a positive stop. So that means when you put your gutta percha through and through, it will not go into the periapical region. Okay, so this process of apexification, how do we achieve that? How do we create that barrier in the apex? So there are two ways of doing it. One is the empty apexification, and the other is the calcium hydroxide apexification. Now the difference between these two is that MTA requires less number of visits. Calcium hydroxide apexification requires more than one visit, more than two visits, multiple visits. Okay, and in calcium hydroxide we need to have some patient compliance as well. We'll have a look at it a little later. But here in the photograph, in the radiograph, can you see the one that is on the left side top? It's an open apex, picture we have seen quite often in the previous slide. And then there is a radio opaque area in the periapical, in the apical third of the root, and this is called as MTA plug. All right, so we use the MTA and we pack the MTA in that area, have a minimum thickness of 3 to 4 mm, and this will form a strong barrier against which we can obturate with gutta percha safely. So the third radiograph that you see is like clearly shows you the MTA plug and then the root canal obturation, and then of course the post endodontic restoration and the tooth is restored. So this MTA apexification can be done in about 2 visits. Let's look at calcium hydroxide technique, because this is one of the most conventional techniques that has been used since a long time before we came to MTA, which is a recent development, maybe 1993 if I remember correctly. Yeah, 1993. So calcium hydroxide was used initially. So what we do in calcium hydroxide is that we open up the we prepare the access cavity and we debride the canal and we disinfect the canal and we leave a slurry of pure calcium hydroxide into the canal, hoping that it protrudes in the periapical area, and then we seal it the access cavity with an interim restoration and we wait. We wait for the calcium hydroxide to instigate the remaining Hertwig sheets in the periapical area, maybe some totipotent mesenchymal cells floating around, and instigated by its high alkalinity to form osteoblast-like cells or osteoclast-like cells. So basically, we are not having any control over what happens in the periapical region, and this is the reason why we have to wait and see what happens. So we have to recall the patient every 3 months and check if an apical barrier has been formed. So if your first two steps are good, that means access cavity preparation and debridement and disinfection, the patient will be relieved of any extra intraoral draining sinus or any pain associated with the tooth, and then the tooth will recover, the infection will die off, the periapical region, the bacteria will die off, and then the totipotent mesenchymal cells, the undifferentiated mesenchymal cells, which it will have an opportunity to interact with calcium hydroxide and then transform itself. So this is basically, it takes a lot of time, so it can take from 6 months to 24 months to have an apical stop, to have the apical barrier. So here is the case where we have used calcium hydroxide, and to just to show you in the radiograph, which is in the middle, that the widest of the widest gutta percha can go through and through. So what you need to do is open up the canal, debride it, disinfect it, and leave calcium hydroxide dressing in the canal for at least 3 months. Recall the patient, open up the access cavity back again, debride the calcium hydroxide from the root canal, and check for a positive stop at the periapical area using a gutta percha. So 5 things can happen when your patient comes back after 3 weeks of calcium hydroxide dressing. One would be a no apparent closure. Okay, so you cannot actually see any closure on the radiograph, but when you insert a file or a gutta percha, you will get a positive stop. That means the file will get a barrier against which you can tap your file or you can tap your gutta-percha, but you have to do it very gently, otherwise you'll break whatever calcific barrier has formed. Or the second possible outcome would be a radiographic evidence of a calcific bridge at the apex. So this is one of the best outcomes you can see. You take a radiograph after 3 months and you see a calcific barrier is there, and you are like, okay, now we can proceed with the obturation. Or you can also have a case scenario where there will be an apical closure, all right, without canal space change. That means the thickness of the root remains the same, but you have an apical closure. Okay, so again, a difficult situation because tooth is prone to fracture because of the thinness of the canals. All right, then the fourth will be a normal continuance of apical closure. So everything goes normally, it is as if nothing has happened and apexogenesis has happened. All right, so this is again a very rare occurrence, but it can occur. So you can have a normal continued development of the apical end of the root. The final would be that there is no change, nothing has happened, the infection remains the same, there is no apical barrier formation and nothing has happened, so your treatment is, you know, it's not working, so you have to go back again and give a calcium hydroxide dressing for another 3 months and call the patient back again for 3 months, take a radiograph and then view the radiograph for any of these possible outcomes. Also, you have to check it clinically, right? So because there will be some cases where there will be no apparent closure on the radiograph, but you will feel a resistance in the Now, this calcium hydroxide was a problem, right? Because the patient had to come every 3 months and then make sure to schedule an appointment. The patient compliance has to be good. The patient has to make an effort to come every 3 months, and this will have to go on till maximum of 2-2.5 years. So sometimes the patient just gives up and never shows up for the appointment. Other problem would be such a long treatment, right? So you cannot obturate the tooth immediately. It takes a very long time. So your case goes on for year, year and a half, and you're not able to complete it. And maybe the patient does not come back, or you move away to a new practice. So it's very difficult with these long durations. And like I told you, root fracture is a very, very common cause with calcium hydroxide apexification, because calcium hydroxide also has been found to weaken the remaining root structure. And the longer you leave it, the more weaken it will do to the root structure. So so in 1993, as soon as the MTA came up and people were very excited, they could pack the MTA on the first appointment after disinfecting the root canal, get that positive stop and maybe obturate in the second visit. So MTA was really a boon for us when it came to calcification. So MTA was introduced by Turabin Nejad in 1993, and basically he introduced it for repairing the lateral root perforation that happens during the conventional RCT. But anyways, it proved a very good dental material for creating apical barrier. So with calcium hydroxide, you had to induce a calcific barrier. With MTA, you create a barrier. So this MTA itself will act as a barrier, right? So MTA is available in two forms or two colors, the gray and the white one. Now the gray color was used initially, and then we found that it is causing raised discoloration of the crown. So we discontinued it, and now we are using the white one. But though the gray is more stronger, but the white one is does not discolor the crown so much. And you have to have full knowledge of MTA. The mixing is in the ratio of 3:1 with sterile water. The initial mix has got a very high pH, just like calcium hydroxide, and the whole MTA sets in approximately 2 to 3 hours. So once you pass those 2 to 3 hours, you are ready for obturating. But you have to make sure the canals are well irrigated and disinfected, otherwise the infection will remain and your treatment will fall. Will fail. So here is a case presented to you. If you see the clinical picture, shows composite restoration on the mesial aspect of both the central incisors, and then the radiograph shows a file which is inserted into the root canal to estimate the root length, and then you perform root canal irrigation and disinfection, and then the apical plug, which is the leftmost radiograph on the second row, and then the obturation is done with gutta-percha and the tooth is restored back into function. So here we have to achieve this MTA plug, which forms as a barrier. Now, with this scheme, a very interesting finding that the people were struggling with root fractures, and people were investigating and researching on the possible ways of regenerating the pulp, right? So when you regenerate the pulp, all the cells in the pulp will come back and the Hertwig root sheath will come back and the normal physiological development of the root will start happening again. So with this objective, or with this objective in mind, people started experimenting, and what they discovered was that if the periapical area of the an immature tooth contains something called as apical papilla, which is rich in stem cells, right? These stem cells are basically undifferentiated mesenchymal cells, and which when placed in a conducive environment, they differentiate themselves depending on what environment they are put into. And here in this case, if we can induce, if we can bring these stem cells into the root canals, they may differentiate into an odontoblast like cells or cementoblast like cells, and we can have continued root formation. So with this concept, a lot of research went on, and we finally discovered a procedure where we can regenerate pulp and achieve physiologic development and maturation of the tooth. When I say maturation of the tooth, I'm talking about the thickness of the remaining root canal. So a matured root will have a thick root structure, and when I say mature, that means the root length will be appropriate for that particular tooth. So they introduce something called as regenerative endodontics. And if you see in the picture A, we have an immature tooth with a necrotic pulp, and in the picture B, after you achieve a disinfection of the canal, you stimulate bleeding by over instrumenting the periapical area. So basically we're trying to irritate the apical papilla, which is present there, so that it bleeds. And once it bleeds, the blood flows into the canal, and when it flows into the canal, you have to obtain hemostasis, okay, help it clot, and that clot you have to protect with the layer of MTA. So this MTA forms a barrier, right, and it protects the clot, and then of course you can go and do your permanent coronal restoration, and then all you need to do is wait for the root apex to form on its own. If your treatment is successful, you will see what is presented to you at the bottom of the slide in the radiograph. So you have this premolar, which got deep caries with an immature with an open apex, right? This would be a blunderbuss apex, and then we perform the regenerative endodontics. So picture B is at the completion of the process of inducing the bleeding from the apex and putting a MTA. The picture C is after 12 months of follow-up. So you see the root maturation has also happened, and the root has elongated to achieve its near closure of its root apex. And after 24 months, that is the D, you see the root apex is closed, right? So this is called as regenerative endodontics, and this is still under the experimental stage. We still have to discover the protocol, but the protocol that I have presented to you works most of the time, and this is what has been recommended by the American Endodontic Association. So but a lot of works are going on, so if you read other ways of doing regenerative endodontic, it's fine. It's not just this one way. This is the oldest and the most reliable one that is presented to you. So with this, we come to two case series, and I want you to maybe stop the recording and think over it and try to answer these questions. So look at this radiograph. So we have this radiograph from a child who is age 10 and who sustained a fracture involving pulp, and he's come to you after 2 weeks of injury, and now he's presenting with symptoms of irreversible pulpitis. And the question that I want to put to you is, what would be your treatment plan for this particular tooth? How are you going to take care of this tooth? We don't want to extract the tooth for in young children, because aesthetically it will be very demanding later to place another implant. We cannot do that at a growing age, cannot put a bridge, so we have to put an RPD. So extraction is never an option, so you need to save the tooth. So maybe you want to hold the recording at the moment and think over it, and then I'll tell you the answer to the question. Okay, the answer to the question is that since the pulp is having irreversible pulpitis, so this is a case for apexification, right? So we have to remove the pulp because pulp is irreversibly damaged, irreversibly degenerated. So we have to remove the pulp and we have to continue with apexification, right? Now, if the patient compliance is an issue, you go ahead and do a two-visit, three-visit MTA, right? And you also have an option of calcium hydroxide. If you do not have MTA in your clinic, you go ahead and perform a calcium hydroxide apexification. But it's always better to have an MTA in the clinic so that you can complete these cases and the patient does not have to come back to you again and again, right? So this is a case for apexification. All right, now look at the radiograph carefully and can you identify the treatment that has been performed for the permanent molar and what kind of treatment has been performed, right? So we see a primary molar also there and we see the permanent molar with the radio opacity, right? So you can pause the recording, the video here, recording here, and think about it and I'll tell you the answer. Okay, so in the picture A, we see that we have a permanent molar which has got a radio opacity in its coronal chamber, pulp chamber, and it's got a radio opacity all over. So basically it has a stainless steel crown. So if it has a stainless steel crown, the pulp therapy has to be done. And if you notice in the picture A, the root apex is open, right? So definitely the operator has performed apexogenesis using coronal pulpotomy. Okay, coronal pulpotomy or conventional pulpotomy. So after he's done his pulpotomy, he's put a stainless steel crown, and he's put a stainless steel crown because the permanent second molar has not erupted. So as soon as the permanent second molar erupts and the occlusal is formed, the more reliable cast metal or porcelain crown can be given for this tooth. So basically this would be a nice case for coronal pulpotomy used to achieve apexogenesis. Alright, so but remember in apexogenesis we never go back into the radicular pulp. We leave the radicular pulp alone. It's healthy because of the root apex has closed and then you don't do anything else. If your apexogenesis fails, then the next step would be what? Can you guess? We have to go for apexification, or worst case scenario, you need to go for an extraction. Alright, so in this session we have learned about two important clinical steps, and I want you to spend 5 minutes to recapitulate and write down the keywords from this presentation, right? And most of the time the questions asked on this topic is how do you differentiate between apexification and apexogenesis, right? So we need to be very, very clear on how to do that. Also, I would like you all to go back to the standard textbook as mentioned in the guidebook. Open up and read from the textbook what they say about apexification and apexogenesis. There are a lot of interesting information there in the textbook, like McDonald and the textbook that is there, the recommended textbook. So you need to go back and read, and then we will have a Google class later where we can hear each other out. If you have any queries, I would love to answer it for you there. Okay, that's it from me right now. This is Dr. Fawaz, and we are ending the session on pediatric endodontics part 3. Have a good day.